finally, it's Radio Deplorable with Dave Carter.
Well, I don't know about you, but I am planning to scream and run.
I am Dave Carter, and this is Radio Deplorable, sponsored by the good folks at Simply Safe, about which more in due course, and by Ricochet.com, which reminds you, the listener, that for a mere $2.50 a month, you can access Ricochet.com in its entirety, including the member side of the house where the really cool kids hang out. And you can also comment on any of Ricochet's podcast posts as well. Just go to Ricochet.com/join to learn more. Lieutenant Colonel Brendan Welsh graduated from the United States Military Academy at West Point in 1989, serving until his retirement from active duty in 2016. Now, what follows are just a few highlights from his career. This is in no way a comprehensive account, but he was an anti-tank platoon leader in Desert Shield and Desert Storm. In 1994, he served as the battalion motor officer with 1st Battalion, 5th Infantry Regiment, 2nd Infantry Division, at Camp Hovey, Republic of Korea. In 1995, Colonel Welsh was assessed and selected to serve in the United States Army Special Forces. After commanding Special Forces Operational Detachment Alpha, otherwise known as the Special Forces A-Team, in the 3rd Battalion, 5th Special Forces Group Airborne, he went on to become an instructor at 1st Special Warfare Training Group Airborne, U.S. Army John F. Kennedy Special Warfare Center at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, eventually becoming a personnel recovery branch chief within the Director of Training and Doctrine before becoming the commander, A Company, 1st Battalion, 1st Special Warfare Training Group Airborne, which is essentially the U.S. Army Survival, Evasion, Resistance, and Escape School. A graduate of the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, Lieutenant Colonel Welsh served as the executive officer for the 2nd Battalion, 7th Special Forces Group, Airborne, before becoming Chief G3 Training Special Skills Branch at the United States Army Special Operations Command, during which time he served 6 months as an augmentee to the Combined Joint Special Operations Task Force, Arabian Peninsula, in Baghdad and Balad, Iraq. Later, at Special Operations Command South at Homestead Air Force Base, he was the Chief Current Operations, Chief Future Operations, and Chief Special Activities within the Directorate of Operations. In 2008, he took command of Special Operations Command Forward Paraguay. In June of 2008, Colonel Welsh took command of the U.S. Army's Iraqi Advisory Group's National Police Team to advise and assist the Iraqi National Police Knights Raid Brigade in Mosul, Iraq. Following a three-month time to ramp up, the team with its four subordinate transition teams deployed to Iraq and spent a year with the Iraqi National Police. Upon his return from Iraq, Lieutenant Colonel Welsh returned to Homestead Air Force Base and the Directorate of Operations, becoming the chief of the Joint Training, Readiness, and Exercises Division until 2011, at which point he was again assigned as chief of the Special Activities Branch. Colonel Welsh's awards include, but are not limited to, the Bronze Star, the Defense Meritorious Service Medal, the Army Meritorious Medal with Bronze Oak Leaf Cluster, the Army Commendation Medal with Silver Oak Leaf Cluster, the National Defense Service Medal with Bronze Oak Leaf Cluster, the Iraqi Campaign Medal with Arrowhead Device, the Global War on Terror Expeditionary Medal, the Korea Defense Service Medal, the Southwest Asia Service Medal with 2 Bronze Stars, the Combat Infantry Badge, which was twice awarded to him, the Expert Infantry Badge, the Liberation of Kuwait Medal, Special Forces Tab, Ranger Tab, Parachutist Badge, Special Operations Diver Badge, and he has earned the Parachutist Badge of Kenya, the United Arab Emirates, Bahrain, Korea, and Colombia. In other words, anyone with the good sense God gave a housefly would refer to this gentleman as Sir, but on Ricochet, we call him Boss Mongo, and it is a pleasure to welcome him to the program now. How are you? Good morning, Lieutenant Colonel Mongo.
Outstanding. Good morning, Dave.
I just reading over this abbreviated version of your military career, I have to wonder, don't you think it's high time you decided to do something with your life?
Yeah, well, it's... that was kind of the preview. Now I'm trying to figure out what phase two is.
Well, I'm kidding, of course. It's at times like that, reading that, that the words that we hear, you know, thank you for your service, seem almost trite. But from one vet to another, first, welcome home, sir. And second, thank you so much for all you've done for our country. There really aren't words to adequately express the gratitude that you're owed. But please know that I and others, a great many others, are profoundly grateful to you.
Thank you very much. But, you know, the flip side of that is for 26 years, I was doing exactly what I was put on this planet to do. So, you
know. Well, yeah, that I understand. I understand that completely. Now, you were kind enough to point me to a story in the ramp up to our interview here that you wrote titled Africa Journal. I love this. The fastest white boy on the continent. And it describes the events that led you at the age of 14, I believe, to consider service in the Special Forces. And I take it your father was in the military during this time?
Actually, my father was an Air Force guy. I communicated with the Air Force. And then during Vietnam, he started doing more work for outfits like Air America than the Air Force. And just kind of drifted over there. So he was an employee of the company. When we were living in Africa.
Okay, got it. And you folks wound up transferring from the United Kingdom to Liberia, where apparently young Brendan found himself one day on the wrong side of a mob that was busy riding in front of the American embassy. Can you walk, or rather run, through the sequence of events that happened that day?
Right, so I was coming back. Our apartment building was not on the embassy compound, but it was just outside one of the gates, and I had to go by the front of the embassy to get there. And of course, there were no phones or cell phones, or, you know, we all had like ham radios in the apartments, but when you're moving, there was no way to get an alert. So I was walking, saw a crowd of people throwing stuff at the front of the embassy and yelling, and some guys were trying to climb the gates, because when your command economy doesn't have enough rice to feed the people or enough oil to keep the turbines going to keep power on, it's obviously the United States' fault. And
was Nancy Pelosi running their economy too?
No, it was even and this is a bold assertion, but it was Master Sergeant Samuel K. Doe was even worse than Pelosi would have been.
Wow.
I think.
Golly.
And he'd taken over about 6 months before we got there. And it was, at the time, it was one of the bloodiest coups in Africa, and there was still pretty much martial law. But he started doing, it was like the Woody Allen film Bananas, you know, where now everyone has to wear their underwear on the outside of their pants. And so the economy quickly went downhill, and you know, Reagan was in office. It was an easy blame to tag it on the U.S. So
sure.
They were having themselves a little riot out in front of the embassy, and I was walking back to the embassy, and then as I got close, maybe 120, 150 meters away, and I was like, probably isn't the best place for me to be right now. So started backtracking, you know.
Yeah.
And like I put in that story, I didn't know then that if you don't want somebody to notice you, don't stare at them.
Right.
And one of the guys in the crowd turned around and saw me, and then, you know, he grabbed two buddies, and they grabbed two buddies, and a group broke off and started basically chasing me. And I didn't know what was going to happen if they caught me, but I wasn't real thrilled with the idea of getting caught. You know, I didn't want to explore the possibilities there, so I was running, and thus the subtitle, The Fastest White Boy on the Continent, because
run, Forrest, run, huh?
Yeah, and I was going down a little pitted road, kind of a service road in the back of a street with houses, and all the houses there have walls around them with, you know, the broken glass mortared into the top, and two gates, you know, the big car gate and then the little people gate.
Right.
And as I was running, a door in front of me opened up, and I was like, oh, this isn't going to be good. And two guys stepped out, and they were a white guy and a black guy, and they were both wearing, you know, Army, the new battle dress uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, hey, man, come on in here. And so I ran in there, and the two guys kind of discouraged the Liberians that were chasing me and sent them away. And then we just hung out the rest of the day until they got a radio call that said it was all clear at the embassy. And and hanging out with those guys, I found out that they were a Special Forces A team that was there to train and hopefully professionalize the Liberian security forces. Mm-hmm. And they'd gotten the call and just forwarded up at the most defensible piece of train they could find. And so we hung out for a couple, 3 hours, and I was like, this is what I want to do when I grow up. So that kind of led me on the road to go in SF. And then my dad, who was a master PSYOPs guy, he knew he couldn't, 14, 15, 16 years old, he knew he couldn't tell me what to do. So he kind of, I used to hang out with the Marine Security Guard Detachment. Right. And, all of my uncles were enlisted. So over the next couple of years, they're kind of like, hey, man, if you're going to go in, go officer.
Right.
If you're going to go officer, you may as well go to an academy. So I said, okay, and put in a packet. My junior year in high school, and my folks noticed when I just started getting more and more literature from West Point, and they're like, my dad was like, hey, have you applied here? I said, yes, sir. And he was like, okay, great. And you could tell he didn't want to like fully endorse it, because then he knew I'd probably rethink what I was doing. But all he said was, you know those guys are serious, right? Like, yes, sir. I didn't know what serious meant at the time, but I found out. And so I ended up going to the academy and then commissioning the infantry. And within a week and a half, 2 weeks of getting to my first unit, I was over in what was then Desert Shield.
Right. In terms of kind of glancing backward toward that 14-year-old kid, and then here you are, having gone through West Point, and now you're in the operational world. In terms of both the training and real-world operations, how did life in Special Forces stack up against whatever preconceived expectations you might have had going in?
That's a good question. It was everything I hoped it would be. And this was obvious when I first got to SF. It was pre-9/11, mm-hmm. and I had an outstanding team, an outstanding team sergeant. And a team sergeant is kind of like, and you might have noticed this from your different perspective, Dave, but, as a young second lieutenant and then a young captain, that first senior NCO that gets a hold of you, it's kind of like a kid in its formative years,
Right.
If you break the guy, he is never going to trust an NCO again. But if you're squared away, he will listen to and back his NCOs 100%.
That's exactly the truth. Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was fortunate enough to have my first infantry platoon sergeant was a 300-pound Samoan named Sergeant Feliga that was just awesome. Although I did learn from him, but also with some of the other Samoans I've worked with over the years, that you have to be very careful the way you articulate the guidance you give them, because they're kind of very literal and very, there's no gray area. Black or white,
right?
And so if I say don't let anybody in and into the office, and then the division commander comes by, sorry sir,
you're not getting in the door.
Right. And then when I went special, and then when I went special forces, I had a great team sergeant who was absolutely committed to, one, seeing me succeed, because that would mean the team succeeded, and seeing me succeed in front of the guys on the team. Best example I can give is we went, when I was still relatively new on the ground, we went out to the Nevada test site, mm-hmm. and off of Indian Springs, kind of in Nevada, and it was great. It was 360-degree range bands, and working up doing some dynamic shooting out there. Whacking Hut Security had a little range kind of right at the gate that mm-hmm. we arranged to use. And so he put the weapons guy to, inspecting all the weapons and counting all the ammo we'd need. And the commo guy was getting the radios ready. Everybody's getting ready for the range the next day. And he said, okay, me and the captain are going to go do a safety check of the range. And they're like, all right, we'll see you guys later. And we went down. I was like, Tim, we got to do a safety check? He was like, no, sir, we're not doing a safety check. I'm running you through the range because the detachment commander is not going to be the worst shot on the team. So let's go. And we spent about 4 hours out there with him putting me through my paces and teaching me to be a better shooter. And the next day I did well. I wasn't, the best shot by any means, but I didn't embarrass myself or, him vicariously through me, I guess.
Right.
And
that's a good
and
NCO
that was kind of
there.
A relationship.
That's a great NCO okay. there.
Oh yeah. I thought the world of this guy. And the thing is I had what in Special Forces, so you got your Halo, free fall teams, you got your scuba teams, you got your mountain teams. And I had what's called an ordinary rucksack team, which means anybody that looked like a Clydesdale got assigned to my team.
Yeah.
Except for the team sergeant, who was probably 5'10", maybe 165, 170 pounds. So when we'd go out and hit the Ville or go out and have, a couple of sodas together, he was the guy that if, depending on how much of a dive the establishment we were at were, he was the guy that would get singled out as the easy guy to target. And it was probably the biggest mistake numerous people have ever made in their lives. The guy was a martial arts dynamo.
Oh.
And he actually got me started on the martial arts piece too, which I've done, my whole life in conjunction with the Special Forces stuff.
Right.
So yeah, I have a deep and abiding one regard and affection for him, but it also let me know what NCOs in general and SF NCOs specifically, what they were capable of and what I could and should expect out of them.
Yeah, I understand. And you mentioned earlier that you were doing what you were born to do, and that actually is one of the things I was going to talk to you about. When I was working as a historian, my family would ask me, how do you like your job? And it wasn't a job. I told them it was a scam because they paid me to learn, I learned things for a living. But it was, and that in context of working in the military was what I was born to do. It just felt right. And I take it that you experienced the same thing in your career, yes?
Yes. I mean, there were times like actually right after the first Gulf War, they kind of opened the floodgates with the peace dividend, and West Pointers who'd been told, hey, it's a minimum 5-year commitment active duty when you graduate, they're letting them go at 2 and 3 years.
Right. Yeah.
And I didn't go just because while, there were some times in the Army, and this is my whole career, I never woke up in the morning and didn't want to go to work, or I never woke up in the morning and thought, man, I'd really like to be doing this other activity, for my life. So I just kind of hung out and stayed with it and, was the best soldier and leader I could be. And it was outstanding.
I don't want to be too intrusive here. And I know that some awards and medals are easier to talk about than others. My parents, for example, never understood how in the world I got a good conduct medal. But I saw that you were awarded the Bronze Star. And so I'd like to ask, if I may, how that award came about.
So to be very clear, and people might not, it was a Bronze Star for service, not for valor with a V device. So it wasn't a specific incident. But I was awarded the Bronze Star after my team, the Mungadai, and our subordinate teams that had awesome politically correct names. Like one team was the Crusaders. One team was the Pig Dogs.
The what?
The Pig Dogs. because Iraqis hate pigs and they hate dogs. So they're like, okay, we're the Pig Dogs.
It's
so
a twofer.
So me and my guys went in and we were a transition team, which meant we were supposed to transition from the coalition forces, which was in most of the time was almost solely U.S. And the Iraqi security forces. So we spent a year, and it was very rewarding, but it was also very. I mean, it was kind of like, even though it wasn't a special, they sought out Special Forces guys and gave them the option of leading these teams, but. When I was in Paraguay, when I popped on this command list and they said, yeah, it's going to be a transition team. And I said, okay, well, I'm in, because the way I was raised, you don't turn down command, even if it was a airborne bath and laundry unit, if they said we're offering you command, you take it.
Right. Yeah.
And, So I called a guy who had been a year or two ahead of me at West Point that I knew really well, and he was kind of the visionary behind it, a guy named John Noggle, who's now a headmaster at some school, but he's a 50-pound brain guy. You know, the Army sent him to Oxford, and he wrote a book called on counterinsurgency called Learning to Eat Soup with a Knife, I think. I might have screwed the title up a little bit. But I called him, and I knew he was involved with this project, and he said, yeah, well, we kind of based these transition teams on the Special Forces A team, you know, only instead of an 18 Bravo weapons NCO, you're going to have a major who's a fire and effects guy. And that's kind of how it works out. Okay. And I was like, okay. And he goes, but let me be very clear. He goes, our assessment and selection is not quite as rigorous as it is for Special Forces. And I was like, well, what's the selection process? He goes, well, we hold a mirror up in front of your face, and if it fogs up, you're on the team. I was like, okay, well, you know, so I signed up for it, and I called back from Paraguay and told the lovely and fetching Mrs. Welsh, you know, Mrs. Mongo, that, hey, honey, they picked me for this thing. I'm going to come back, and then I got to go for 15 or 16 months, and, you know, the Army kind of tapped me, and she was like, you don't lie to me. You volunteered for this thing. I said, yeah, hey, baby, it's a command. And,
so, hey, come on now. It's the Foggy Mirror Brigade. Now we have to do this.
Yeah. And, you know, she was in the Army. She was a vet of the first Gulf War, and she was an Army nurse. And she knew, you know, exactly what she was signing up for when she hitched to my sorry behind. So she was like, okay, I got it. I got the home front. Go and do great things. So we went over, and I was incredibly fortunate in that the Foggy Mirror Brigade guys that I got assigned were just amazing. Mm-hmm. And they were great. My team sergeant, again, my senior NCO, was both a former Ranger instructor and he'd been to Mosul before, and he had been an instructor at the Joint Rotation Training Center in Fort Polk, Louisiana, that everybody rotates through. Yeah. And he was one of the guys that grades units on their performance when they go through. So just a phenomenal NCO.
Right.
And all my NCOs were great. All my officers were pretty good. I had to do some in-depth coaching, teaching, and mentoring with a couple of them. But it was awesome. And so we spent the Bronze Star, going back, that was for the year in Mosul, working with the Knights Raid Brigade, or Suatul Forsan, in Mosul. And it was interesting because we had zero of the enablers that I was used to. You know, as SF guy, you get used to having, you know, at least one predator feed going on, looking at the objective. You got, you know, you got your own, not going into detail, but you got your own stuff,
right,
that enables you to do the mission. And,
yeah,
and we had none of that. It was just us and our Iraqi partners. And that year was, Mosul was kind of held out as the last stand of Al Qaeda in Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
And so we did a lot of hooking and jamming, and it was a great, phenomenal year.
You know, you mentioned almost casual, well, not casually, but in passing, you mentioned your wife's, who's also a veteran, her response to this, go and do great things. And that underscores the point that I've seen over the years, both in uniform and then when I drove that military show truck for very special events. The families serve every bit as much as the person in uniform. And I don't think a lot of folks – well, you can't really understand them unless you've been there, I suppose, what they go through holding down the fort, as it were, while the rest of us are off, you know, sucking rubber in a gas mask or whatever. So.
Right. Oh, absolutely. The families are amazing, and you know, I was gonna stick with her for the long haul anyway. You know, because financially it's cheaper to keep her. But no,
I want to be there when she hears this podcast. This will be great.
She's waving to you. She's actually sitting
okay.
Like I said, she knows exactly who she married. So, but no, she held it together. You know, every time I was gone, and you know, sometimes she will not hesitate to whip out of the rucksack of wifely grievances, you know, the fact that there were times I was gone like 22 out of 24 months, you know? Mm-hmm. And she was, it was kind of like, hey, I got to go. And she was like, okay, I got it. Now, the flip side of it is when, because if you saw my bios, I got assigned to Special Operations Command South in Homestead in 2005 and spent kind of the rest of my career there when I wasn't deployed or on a long trip that wasn't necessarily deployment, but it was a TDY type of thing. We did the recon of Homestead Air Reserve Base, which got flattened by Andrew in 93, I think. Hurricane Andrew. And so we were coming from Fort Bragg, which is this kind of its own city, to Homestead, and we're driving across like the 300 meters. It's not active runway. And she was like, really?
Right.
This is where you think you're going to move me? And I was like, she said, I'm picking where we're going to live. I was like, okay, baby, we'll live wherever you want. Just don't leave me. And so we moved down to Key Largo, and her and the kids loved it. And the Army knew that her and the kids loved it. So they'd come up and they'd go, hey, every couple, 3 years, because the Army wants you to move around a lot in this mad quest to make you a Renaissance man. But the Army would come to me and go, hey, Welsh, we know the missus and your kids love it down in Key Largo. Tell you what, if you take this really I'm trying to work with the code of conduct here. If you take this really not nice deployment or job, and you
forget I have the beep button over here.
Yeah. And if you go away for 6 months or a year, when you come back, we'll reset your clock.
Oh.
I'm like, man, I don't want to get shot at again. And so I'd ask, you know, lovely and talented Mrs. Welsh, hey, baby, the Army offered me another one of those. She'd be like, okay, bye. Stay safe. Okay, wait, what? No. We'll see you when you get back.
Right.
All right. So it was one of those deals. But no, she is just a hero, you know. She.
Well, I can tell.
She did it all. You know?
As I can tell, you were certainly blessed in that regard.
Absolutely.
In our correspondence leading up to our chat today, you mentioned that you got a few good laughs out of the stories that my two military buddies and I traded on a recent podcast about our time in Korea and some of the craziness that went on. And I have to assume that you've seen more than your fair share of craziness in your many experiences. Anything code of conduct compliant that stands out in your memory?
I don't know. You know, I kind of thought this this question might, and it's code of conduct, but it's also statute of limitations. Right?
Oh, there we go. Okay, that's even better.
There's two things. One is, I'm a big believer as a leader, you know, and a manager, and you know, a director and stuff. I'm a big believer in, you know, that any group of humans you put together, whatever dimension you look at them in, there's going to be a bell curve, right?
Right.
And so figure out where the thing about being an SF guy is, compared to the normal population, every dude is so much an outlier, either to the left or the right of the bell curve of normal human beings, mm-hmm. that they're just a different kind of cat.
Sure.
And every now and then we had, so the one that I'll put out, it was the only time I kind of got involved and personally involved in pulling something on one of my guys.
Mm-hmm.
Was we'd done a long trip to Africa when I was a detachment commander, and we were out in the middle of nowhere. It was awesome. We were like an hour away by very rough terrain from our company that also deployed on this exercise. And we spent a long time on this game preserve called Archer's Post. And it was literally like there was a rock out there that we called Pride Rock. I mean, it was right out of The Lion King.
Yeah.
And it was great. We worked with the Kenyan 5th Infantry Rifles, a company from them, a company of their engineers. And then we did some jumping and stuff with their 20th para. And just a phenomenal trip, and it's, you know, it's what you kind of sign up to do when you go SF, was just be out in the middle of nowhere. You know, they dropped us off with some tent and a pallet of MREs and a water buffalo full of water, which, sorry, you know, I know you know what it is, but it's just a big water tank on wheels kind of thing.
Thank you. I wasn't even thinking to clarify that because I've dealt with so many of them. But okay, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so we were just left out there. It was like 8 or 9 weeks. Well, on my team, we had kind of a tradition where we had a no-kidding rubber chicken. And whoever came back from a deployment with the rubber chicken in his kit was buying the beer when you got back. And for some reason, my 18 Bravo weapons NCO just got fixated on making sure I would come home with the rubber chicken to the point where he would hide it in my gear and then fret about it for 2 or 3 days and then go back into my gear to hide it somewhere else. Yeah. You know? And I kind of reached my limit. So when we were redeploying, I went to my medic, and at the time, I think they would offer up if you want. I never did them because I don't like meds. But at the right. time, I think the sleeping pill choice was Halcyon. And I was like, hey, I don't want to use guys' names when I'm pre-cleared it with them, but I was like, hey, medic. You got any of those Halcyons on? He was like, yes, sir, I do. And I was like, how many can you safely take? And he was like, one. I was like, no. But I mean, really, how many could you safely take? He was like, one. I was like, okay, give me three of them. when we stopped to refuel in Rota, Spain, being the captain, I went out and bought all the guys' sodas and brought them back to where we were hanging out. And crushed up and put three of those Halcyon in my weapons guy's coat.
Oh, wow.
And made sure he got the one with the Mickey in it.
Yeah.
And then, he fell asleep on the ride back. So I went to the baggage pallet and kind of reached in where I knew he'd hidden this rubber chicken. And he was out, and I kind of, I told the medic, hey, keep an eye on him. You know, I wanted to get him back, but I didn't want to kill the person. So on the way back, I pull the rubber chicken out, and the medic cuts his uniform trouser off, like on the high thigh. We take the rubber chicken, put it up against the guy's knee, wrap it up with an ACE bandage, tape it up, and then put one of those plastic kind of flex casts over his leg.
Right.
And he was out the entire time. And as we're making the approach back in, we were not jumping in. We usually jumped in when we came back home. But for whatever reason, we were flying a C-17, and it's really weird where you have to have more fuel than X but less fuel than Y in order to safely jump out of it. And so we were going to air land and just, get our pallets of stuff and return them to the team room and account for our sensitive items. And so we finally, as we're going to land, we woke up the weapons guy, and we're like, hey, man. Time to get up. And he was like, oh, and he's looking at his legs. Like, what happened? I was like, you don't remember falling off the pallet when we were in Rota? He's like, no. I was like, yeah, man, you screwed up your knee pretty good. And he was like, yeah, it really hurts. I was like, yeah. And so anyway, we downloaded all our stuff, and we got everything accounted for and all that. And then the medic was like, hey, brother, let me look at that leg. And he said, okay. So he takes off the plastic cast. Unwraps the ACE bandage. Oh, and we'd also, like I said, taped up the ACE bandage, and we taped it in such a way that we knew it would take a lot of that leg hair with it.
Sure.
So we ripped that off, and the guy looks down, and there's the rubber chicken taped to his leg. It's like, oh. So I kind of made an enemy for life there, but I thought I made the statement that needed to be made. So
that's good. That is when the movie comes out, it's going to be even better. I like that. That's all right. We are talking with Boss Mongo, also known as Lieutenant Colonel Brendan Welsh, U.S. Army and Special Forces retired. I oftentimes ask my guests for a few of their favorite songs. And this is one of the good colonel's favorites. This is called Put Your Lights On by Santana. It's featuring Everlast. Hey now,
Dave Carter.
All right, let me talk to you about something. Here it is, summer vacations. There's still a little time left. Spend a few days at the beach or take the kids to the amusement park. Kiddos love summer, right? Well, you know who else loves summer? Burglars, because they know that you'll do all of those things and that you'll leave your house empty. Summer is prime time for burglary, and pretty soon burglars will be counting the number of shoplifting days until Christmas as well. So now is the time to protect your home. For a limited time, you can take a whopping $100 off Simply Safe's special summer package. This is Simply Safe's biggest ever summer sale. It is everything you need to protect your home, an arsenal of security sensors to secure each door and every window. Your Simply Safe system comes with a panic button, a blaring extra siren, and wireless connection to authorities and police dispatch. Your family, your home, and everything in it will stay safe around the clock. With Simply Safe, there are no long-term contracts, no installation costs, no hidden fees, and 24/7 professional monitoring is just $14.99 a month. So see what Simply Safe can do for your home. Get $100 off your Simply Safe security package when you type in simplysafe.com/ricochet. Now, this offer is not indefinite, so take advantage of it now. That's spelled SIMPLISAFE.com/ricochet. For $100 off your purchase, you be got to try that. SimplySafe.com/ricochet. Check it out. Hey, Boss Mongo.
Yes, sir.
How did the name Boss Mongo come about?
So when I took that transition team over to Iraq, our team was Team Mungadai. And we chose that call sign because the Mungadai were Genghis Khan's kind of special ops unit. And they were his shock troops, if you will.
Okay.
And when old GK rolled through Mosul in about 1351, the Mungadai had, like I said, picked the most politically incorrect thing you could. We just kind of alluded to it. So we were Team Mungadai. Well, you know, radio operators for the coalition forces, you know, didn't know what a Mungadai was.
Right.
So we got called everything from Munjodis to Monkey Knights. But the one thing the battle space owner unit kind of settled on was Mongo, the Mongos.
Okay.
And so my call sign kind of just became Boss Mongo. And when I joined the site, I was still an active duty guy, and I didn't think it was appropriate to have my true name up there because it would look like as a military officer, I was endorsing a certain political point of view, something like that. So I just put up Boss Mongo, and only ever posted about, you know, posts about puppies or something like that. And then when I retired, when I went on terminal leave to retire, that's when I started posting everything. But the Boss Mongo name kind of goes back to that year in Mosul.
You know, I am so glad that I resisted the temptation to put in some sound clips from Blazing Saddles Mongo into our festivities today. Man, that would have been a disaster. Wow.
Well, And that also led, I mean, that was also part of the Mongo thing, because I was, I've had to drop a little weight since I got out, but it would not have been, back in the day, it would not have been too much of a stretch.
Mongo-like. Okay. Let's change gears a little bit, if I may, and talk about current events. Now, this may be a bit out of your particular expertise, given that it's an issue in the Navy right now. But I'm just curious. I know they've relieved, I believe, the 7th Fleet Commander after these various incidents. I'm hearing news reports that the latest mishap may have been caused by human error. In your mind, does that speak to a training issue, just kind of looking from the outside but with some experience in that kind of thing?
Yes, a training issue, but also a cultural issue, because there have been, what, 3 major collisions?
Right.
And some of it might be technical. So there might be, and I don't know, and I haven't looked out, and I'm not privy to that information now, but it could be someone spoofing GPSs or spoofing, you know, onboard radar on the ships. But still, a big part of being a sailor is standing watch.
Right. Even, even if
watching for another big ship. And it wasn't like these were little sailboats. These were like super tankers,
right?
And super cargo vessels. And so, yeah, there's something going wrong when, you know, big ocean, you know, little ships comparatively running into each other. I think it's a training issue, but it's also, I think, a cultural issue that it could happen. You know, I don't know what.
Yeah, I've been scratching my head trying to figure out what was. I mean, you've been on active duty much more recently than I have, for example. So you tell me, would I be out of line or off the mark if I speculated that those sailors are most assuredly up to speed on all their human relations training, their diversity and sensitivity training, their acceptance of men in the ladies' room training, but that they may, as a consequence, may not be as ramped up as they might otherwise be in their operational training? Is that too much of a stretch on my part?
No, I mean, the thing is, honestly, you can do both. You know, my unit has some of that coming up. It's like, you know, there's the SHARP program, which is sexual harassment and assault reduction and prevention training, which is like a 2 or 3 hour block. There's suicide prevention training. There's and the thing is about all the and you get, my gosh, when you get ready to retire, the amount of mandatory training you have to do. It's just but it's all just CYA training, you know. And it's so when you screw up, they say, "Hey, he was trained."
Right.
But at the same time, how hard is it to say, "Okay, my watch on the bowsprit of the ship I'm on is from 02 to 04:30. I got to stand here and look for a ship." You know, that's a cultural thing. If guys are blown that off, not just a training.
That's
thing.
True.
In my view.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you've got redundant systems, and among those redundancies, one would think would be, you know, human beings looking out physically from the ship.
Right. I'm privileged enough to work right now. You know, I'm a contractor doing stuff at the unit I retired out of, and it's awesome. I mean, we've got Air Force combat controllers, we've got Navy SEALs, we've got Army SF guys, plus all our logistics guys who are just amazing. And I was asking one of the SEALs, you know, because they go on float all the time. I was like, "How does that happen?" And he's like, "I don't know, man. He goes, something is just wrong, you know." So,
yeah. Okay, now the president, switching gears again. I don't want to give you whiplash, but the president recently made a pretty important speech with respect to his approach to the war on terror generally, and Afghanistan in particular. As far as I could see. From his refusal to telegraph our plans and tactics to the enemy, his insistence that our actions would be conditions-based rather than calendar or time-based, delegation of authority to the front lines versus folks having to call Mother May I to the headquarters and seek permission from some, you know, faceless geek, and his declining to pursue nation-building in favor of terrorist elimination, it seems to me at least like a rather dramatic break with previous policy. What say you? How do you read all that?
I think everything you said is positive. I'll tell you that one of the most frustrating things for the SF guys that are over there is when you get an intel lead and you say, "Hey, one of our targets or one of our high value targets is going to be at this place at this time." Mm-hmm. The process to get permission to roll out the gate is way too bureaucratically late. You know, you have to do a concept of the operation or what we call a con-op. You have to send it up, and all the guys at the higher headquarters who are smarter than you are going to send it back down 19 times with recommended corrections, changes, and, you know, tactical advice, which
sure.
You know, teams really appreciate. And then and then a lot of times before you can get approval, that window to go get a guy has passed, you know,
right.
or
right.
Before you can guarantee that there won't be any collateral damage or, you know, so anything to let the boys get after it is going to be a net positive. You know, what I have heard that some of the boys were doing was to go out and just do a security patrol. You didn't have to send up a con-op. You only had to send out a 5W. Much easier process because you're not saying, you know, "I'm going out on a dedicated mission to get this guy," you know, roll out and control. But the problem is guys, in order to get to the target in these windows of time, would send up a 5W, but you can't get dedicated air support on a 5W.
Okay.
but you can on a con op. So guys would go out, and then they'd have what we'd call a tick, which is troops in contact. They'd call up for the emergency air support. Well, there might be two or three or four teams that are all in contact. So you've got to wait your turn instead of having dedicated air. Just one of the frustrations that, the guys have put up with for years and years.
So that's going to recede.
So if he lightens that, and there's got to also be a cultural shift with that, right? I mean, we were just talking about cultures in the Navy. In the Army or in joint forces, there's got to be a cultural shift where subordinate commanders understand I've got to trust my guys enough to let them roll out and trust them enough that they've got the judgment, maturity, and tactical and technical proficiency to go out and do the job without me micromanaging them. So changing the rules will help, but there's also got to kind of be the change in culture that goes with it.
And that doesn't just magically happen because the commander-in-chief said, now you've got the authority. They actually have to, like you said, there's got to be a culture change. Is that going to be a tough bill to fill?
It depends. I think within our special operations forces, it won't be. I think for the conventional forces or what we call the general purpose forces, I think it will be, because some of it, like the 7th Fleet commander getting relieved, the commander is responsible for everything his subordinates do or fail to do. So some guys are, and it goes back to what were their NCOs like, what was their command climate like when they were coming up. But some guys just don't feel comfortable giving their troops to make the latitude to make their own decisions. And so that would have to change to really change things on the ground, in my opinion.
Yeah, because a lot of people have come up in leadership ranks in a I guess I'd call it a risk-averse culture.
Yeah, they did. I mean, I topped out as a lieutenant colonel, and that was probably as far as it was appropriate for me to go. But again, with my experiences and I was not risk-averse. In fact, really, I'm the kind of guy that is the reason why there's oversight, or as much oversight as there is.
Yeah.
And So I understand it's kind of a tightrope that the commander has to walk. He's got to get a feel for pushing down those decisions without pushing them down where later somebody with 20/20 hindsight, probably affiliated with the military judge advocate general office, is going to look at and say, "Hey, you shouldn't have done that this way."
Right.
So you got to just have a culture that encourages appropriate risk taking,
right?
And then everything hinges on that word appropriate, right?
And there are so many different personalities. When I was active duty as a historian, I was on the commander's staff, so I worked directly for, oh gosh, three dozen or more flag officers. They were my direct supervisor, and you'd see, but risk aversion was a common issue on all kinds of fronts, and which somehow aligned with career advancement, but that's a whole different deal.
Right.
General Mattis was, prior to being Secretary of Defense, he was at CENTCOM, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
Okay. How do you think he's going to take to this new culture and facilitate or not facilitate that filtering down through the ranks?
Mattis is a risk taker.
Okay.
And one of the reasons, I mean, and McMaster's is a good guy. I've read his stuff and know him a little bit. Mattis, I know a little bit because I've had to work with him on a couple of projects. And then the other one is General Kelly will be a good guy interpreting, what could be viewed as bad news or what could be spun as bad news. Kelly's going to be a great guy to kind of be his Rosetta Stone when it comes to evaluating military successes or failures. And I think there's a reason why you have guys like, I think specifically Mattis, specifically General Kelly, is those are the two leaders I would pick out, the two military senior leaders when they topped out as 4 stars. Those were the two guys, both Marines, both just hewed to the warrior code,
right.
And I heard General Kelly say some stuff when I worked for him that I was – I was pleased, but also amazed and scared for the guy, because I was like, you can't be this apolitical and be a general officer these days.
Not for long, at any rate.
Right. But Kelly did it, and Mattis did it, and I think they're great guys to have at the position they're at right now.
Good. That's encouraging to hear. If you could implement your own policy with respect to the war on terror, given your experience from mud level to command level and your own training and education, what would that policy look like? Would it differ very much from what we're hearing from President Trump now?
It would a little bit. Not actually, I don't think it would. Differ that much on the themes, but I think in the details it would. And since Confederate generals and historical figures are under so much fire now, I'll quote Nathan Bedford Forrest and say that, you know, we have to accept, both as a military and as a society, that, you know, to quote Forrest, war means fighting means killing. You know,
right.
And we've got to understand that there's not always going to be a perfect tactical scenario. There's not always going to be operations with no collateral damage. And we've got to not apologize for it. We've got to put the blame where it lies, which is with these violent extremist organizations, particularly the Islamists. Mm-hmm. And we've got to get after them. And now it's true. And I know General McMaster would be the first guy to tell me, hey, you can't kill your way out of insurgency. And my rejoinder to that would be, yeah, but you can't defeat an insurgency without doing some killing. And I think we've been very skittish about that for myriad reasons.
Was that in part due to General McChrystal's hearts and minds approach? Do I have that right?
Yeah. Well, I've got a good friend who's still in who is a Jedi Knight, and his interpretation of that was, hey, sometimes hearts and minds are just a sight picture,
right?
You know? Yeah, you line up the front sight and the rear sight and go for hearts and minds,
right?
The thing is you can do both, but like I would say, what we didn't invest in enough, but it had a lot of promise in Afghanistan. And I'll tell you, Afghanistan might well be intractable, right? I mean, there might not be a winning scenario. President rightfully used the word victory, but if we're going to commit to victory in Afghanistan, that's going to mean some nation building. It's going to mean some hearts and minds. But the thing is you don't send guys over for 1-year rotations or with soft 6-month rotations and change hearts and minds. We're talking, it's a generational thing. I mean, if you're gonna commit to that hearts and minds piece, you've got to realize that it is a long-term endeavor. And probably the best example of us doing it right would be Colombia, which wanted to defeat the FARC. And when one of my personal heroes, President Uribe, took over, the FARC was powerful enough that his predecessor, on his last day in office, the FARC mortared the executive mansion in Bogota. And it went from that over Uribe's tenure to the FARC being willing to come to the negotiating table just because they'd had the snot knocked out of them. You know, we'd been in Colombia 30 years, 40 years, and this was a country that was, it's different than us culturally, but not radically different like what we have in Afghanistan. And it still took us a good 30 years of engagement to bring about a change to where the Colombians could support themselves.
As long as we're solving world issues, real quick, one last question on that. What do you think we ought to do about North Korea and that little gargoyle with the bad haircut over there?
That's another one where I don't know that there are any good answers. I think we're doing right as far as bringing China in and saying, hey, you're going to be held accountable for this guy's shenanigans. I think it's the best thing we can do for managing that. But again, we're talking, you know, and then do we really want that regime to come down dramatically enough that there's a change and the DMZ is done away with and Korea is reunified. I mean, if you look at the economic hit that Germany took when the wall came down and Germany reintegrated East and West, they took a very big, you know, economic hit, and right. It took them a while to recover. And East Germany was kind of the crown jewel in the Soviet bloc, right? Compare that with you've got South Korea, which is phenomenally successful, but the hit they would take if Korea was reunified would be pretty significant, you know. And just two totally different countries now because they've had that totalitarian, unblinking eye state in the north for so long that I remember when I was in Korea and I was there when Kim Il-sung died.
Right, I was there too that same time.
Yeah, and we were going through the nuclear negotiations and we were ready for High Adventure to kick off.
Right,
and at the time, and you might have heard this story, but at the time they were doing the nuclear negotiations and they had one of the conferences in Seoul. And the North Korean delegation got its nose out of joint and like stormed off. And it was because going through Seoul, and I'm sure you see it's a traffic madhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And the North Koreans suspected that the South, as a PSYOPs campaign, had taken every car in the country and put it on the roads that the North Koreans would be in. I mean, they just could not picture. No, this is like every day, you know.
I did not hear about that. That's wow.
Yeah. And so that's kind of, you know, that's kind of, and that was before, I mean, Kim Il-sung was, you know, a bad guy, but he was rational in what he did. He had a
right.
program. And then you go through his son and now his grandson, and they're getting wackier, you know, and his grandson has been raised to believe that he actually can get, you know, 14 holes in one on an 18
right.
whole golf course.
Yeah.
You know?
And who's going to tell him otherwise?
Right. Yeah. I mean, what, he's killing guys with flamethrowers and dogs and
right.
and tying them spread eagle to the front of artillery pieces. I don't know how you profile the guy's psyche to get the most effects from him. But I do think that leaning on the Chinese and saying, hey, you're gonna bear some responsibility for whatever happens, I think will work
right,
because North Korea can't lose its Chinese support.
Well, they bear some responsibility for the current state of things in any event. So,
right.
Okay, we'll shift gears one last time, and this will be the last question. But I often ask this question of veterans, and you heard me ask it of the two gentlemen I spoke with a few weeks ago. There are certain days that stand out in the minds of people. Most everyone remembers where they were when the Space Shuttle Challenger exploded shortly after takeoff. Most folks who are old enough to remember know exactly where they were when they heard that President Kennedy had been assassinated. Take me back to 9/11, if you don't mind. And where were you when all that unfolded? And how'd you handle all that?
So I was in command of U.S. Army SEER school on 9/11, and I was driving. So you have Fort Bragg. Outside of Fort Bragg, you've got a place called Camp McCall, which is out in the pine forests of North Carolina. It was about a 45-minute drive from one to the other, and that's where most of the Special Forces pipeline training takes place. So the qualification course, the Special Forces Assessment and Selection Course, and Special Assessment and Selection Course, and the SEER School were all out there. And so I was driving. We lived on post at Fort Bragg, and I was driving out to Camp McCall. And I was listening to some morning radio show, John Boy and Billy, and they said, hey, a plane has just hit the World Trade Center. And I didn't know if it was a bit they were doing or anything. And I'll never forget, the guy said, hey, look, we don't do this very much, but you might want to switch over to a real news radio station because we're good at fart jokes, but we're not good at covering this kind of stuff.
Right.
And I was like, so on the way out to Camp McCall, kind of en route, was what we call the Resistance Training Laboratory, which is our prison camp that we put guys through. And I pulled off over there, and it looks like a, you know, it's very painstakingly done to look genuine. And so I went into the cadre hooch there, and saw the second plane hit. And you know, and it's always been ironic to me that I was in this replication of a prison camp. The satellite dish that the cadre got their video feed through actually had a hammer and sickle stenciled onto it. Mm-hmm. And wow. I went in and I was like, okay, everything has changed. And it took me, when I came home from work that day, I want to say it took me 5 or 6 hours to get back to, you know, to do my 45-minute ride back to Fort Bragg. As soon as it happened, the lovely in town and Mrs. Mongo got our scoop. We had at the time a Scooby-Doo van, you know, big custom pop job for the four kids.
Yeah.
And she went to the high school and the elementary schools and picked up our kids and a bunch of other kids that were friends of ours. She got them released and was like on the phone on the way in, having parents call in to say, Mrs. Welsh can take my son home, because she knew they were gonna lock the base down.
Yeah,
and you know, and all my kids remember it. They were, you know, they were like from 15 on to like 4 or 5. And like my kids can remember, you know, the Humvees parked on the intersection of the housing areas, manned with crew served weapons. And mm-hmm. you know, they were running outside and bringing bags of M&Ms to the soldiers and stuff like that. They didn't really get what's going on, but we were just like, okay, we're going. And it kind of broke my heart that I was on a schoolhouse rotation at the time, because, you know, I'd been a fifth group guy, and a lot of those guys that went in right away were my boys, you know.
Yeah, well, like so many of us, you're champing at the bit.
Oh yeah, I mean, everybody, you know, in my line of work was like, all right, it's on, you know. And talking to my guys, when my former guys, when they rotate back through, they were like, you know, the first couple months was awesome. And then they started sending officers over, you know.
Yeah.
Not the captains, not the majors, which in special forces, everything's one rank up except for battalion command, which is a lieutenant colonel. But, you know, companies are commanded by majors. A teams are commanded by captains. And they were like, we could work with the majors and the captains, but once all them lieutenant colonels showing up, you know, it became a different thing. Mm. And, you know, but at first the guys were, you know, and they did something that nobody would believe could be done, you know, bringing down the Taliban with the Northern Alliance as quickly as they did.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was due to our ability to work with, I mean, it was the first time since Vietnam that we had strategic air assets supporting tactical elements on the ground, and it worked. You know, they just scrambled some eggs, and you know, and so it's been, you know, things got pretty busy for me, and you know, for, well, all the way through retirement, really. So.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's good when things work as advertised, the way they're supposed to, before it gets messed up. But it's a shame, at the same time, that it had to happen that way, you know. Like I was talking with my buddies, you spend all this time trying to keep the bad guys over there, and then they hit you over here.
Yeah, absolutely. But I had kind of had a, you know, that, I mean, what you, I'm trying to say, my mindset, I mean, we were all kind of afraid something like that would happen, because it's only got to happen once, right? And you get a 9/11. And I remember what you just said, you spent all that time over there hoping it never comes here. You know, I remember my dad was tore up when, I can't remember his name, but Pakistani guy that at the turn to go onto the campus at Langley, the CIA campus at Langley, he just started walking down the turning lane with an AK-47. And, wow. You know, my dad wasn't on the campus that day, or wasn't going to the campus that day, but he said the exact same thing. And that kind of opened up my eyes, right, that, hey, it can happen here, and we need to guard against it. And, you know, I think America writ large really needs to recalibrate, because awful things can happen here. And I think we have a very hard time imagining how bad a vast swath of humanity is, and what they would do with us without batting an eye. I mean, you know, you read the news today, and you know, one of the things that upsets me is the total ahistorical appreciation that any of the kids that are protesting have, you know, on either side, to say, hey, okay, you know, the great men that you're protesting about, go back to our founders. I mean, they were great in spite of their human frailty and in spite of their human shortfalls. Not, you know, they're not held up because of those. They're held up because they did great things without that. And
right.
And losing that perspective is something that, you know, I'm very concerned about right now.
That, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And that, I mean, it's been said before, not all great men were necessarily good men all of the time.
Right.
I mean, we all suffer from a condition that we inherited from Adam, I believe. So that's my faith at any rate. So. Well, it has been an honor to have you on the program this morning. We'll have to do this some more, because we're not through solving all the world's problems yet, so we'll have to have you back on here. This is great fun, but it has been.
We do need to do it again, solve some more problems, although I will tell you, I'm way too sober for worldwide problem solving right now. So.
All right, well, then we'll drink, and then we'll solve it. But again, it's been an honor. I really appreciate you taking the time out of your weekend to chat and share your experiences and perspective on events. And I look forward to hearing even more from you on Ricochet as well. So thank you, sir.
Absolutely. Thank you, Dave.
Folks, if you've enjoyed hearing Boss Mongo, I would respectfully remind you that he is one of many truly delightful people that you can encounter on Ricochet and on Ricochet's member feed. And I would also remind you that you can have access to that feed in addition to adding your own comments to this podcast post, as well as others, for just $2.50 a month. That's less than a cup of coffee and will stimulate your mind as much as any amount of caffeine you can imagine. Just go to ricochet.com/join and join the festivities. With thanks again to my guest, Boss Mongo, and to you, the listener, I am Dave Carter for Radio Deplorable on ricochet.com. Everybody.